Hello, dear students. Last class we had discussed about paramagnetism and ferromagnetism. Paramagnetism and diamagnetism, which are generally linear in nature because they depend on the magnetization or external field. Therefore, linear nature because magnetization depends on the external field. Whereas in the case of ferromagnetism, they don't depend on the external field to retain their magnetization. So ferromagnetism essentially is non-linear in nature. Now, as we have discussed, magnetization depends on the alignment of dipoles. Suppose we are having a small patch and you are having dipoles properly aligned. So, alignment of dipoles to a particular field. So, in ferromagnetism, there is alignment of dipoles, but there is a catch. There are so many alignment is in patches. That means one patch will be aligning all the dipoles in one direction, another patch will be in another direction. So, that means, let us put them like this. That means they are individually oriented and collectively random. That means though the individual dipoles are and these individual individually oriented patches are known as, you can put it here itself, these are all called domains. Now, what happens if you apply an external field? When you apply an external field, what happens is that one domain emerges, one domain which is along the direction of the field gains strength, and in this way shrinking all other domains till the whole material is magnetized in the particular direction. Okay, that means one domain which is in the same direction as that of the field increases in size and shrinking all other domains. Now, as we have said, one domain that is favorable domain grows at the expense of others. Now, what will happen if you are having some magnetic piece and you are giving it some current, let us say you are giving it to a current supply, let us say you are applying some current, then what happens to the magnetization? I will try to draw a curve. Let us keep this as this is M and this is I. This is the current and this is the magnetic. This is the current and this is the magnetization. So, naturally what happens? You start with origin, you increase the current, magnetization increases. Then it reaches a point which is known as saturation point. When you further increase, there is no further increase in the magnetization. That is, let us name this point as B. Let us name as the initial point A. So, when you increase the current, there is an increase in magnetization until a point, and this point is known as saturation. Now, then what you do? You want to decrease the current. When you decrease the current, it does not retrace the same path. It comes back to a point like this. And this point is known as C, let us say. That means you are decreasing the current, but the magnetization is not going to zero. So you try to further decrease it in the opposite direction. Again, now the magnetization is zero. When you further decrease the current, again something like this happens. Again there is a saturation point, only thing is alignment is in the opposite direction. let us name it some, this has some, maybe B prime, let us name this as or B prime or something. Then here it is, you are reversing the current. That means if the current was in forward direction, let us say current was in here forward direction, then current will be here in reverse direction. This is the current. So now when you are reversing it, again the same thing happens. Again you want to decrease the current, nothing much happens. And again the same process continues. Okay. So this term you call it saturation point. This term is, you call it a retentivity point. And some the books, this term is known as coercivity point. But the important part is, it never retraces the full curve. So you don't get back to, if you decrease the current, you don't get back to A. You trace a curve. The conventional hysteresis curve is generally taken between B and H, where B is the resultant magnetic field and H is the external magnetic field. Let us write it external magnetic field. In the absence of iron, in the absence of iron, that means this is the actual magnetic field you are applying, and this is the magnetic field, the total magnetic field including the induced one. Sum total of all magnetic fields. Again, this also follows the same magnetic curve. You are taking mu 0 h into 10 raised to 4 because you have to balance this and this. Okay. And this curve is known as hysteresis loop because we starting from A and but we are never reaching A directly. That means the external magnetic field, the magnetization is not actually following the magnetic field. Always the magnetization is lagging behind the magnetic field. And therefore, we call this loop as hysteresis loop. Hysteresis itself means actually lagging behind. And one more thing which we want to emphasize while discussing magnetization is the concept of Curie point. Now, Curie point is something like a point, something like ice point for water. That is, above 0 degree it is water, below 0 degree it is ice, something like that. Above Curie point, that is if you, it is paramagnetic, below Curie point it is ferromagnetic. That means, if you want to make a magnet or an iron magnet lose its magnetization, sample lose its magnetization, heat it up to 770 degrees centigrade, then all the domain walls will dissolve and it will become a randomly oriented dipoles like a paramagnetic material. So this is it. Thank you.